Okay, so in the last class, we were looking at pass transistors and how they can be used in order to implement certain kinds of logic. And the major drawback that we saw as far as pass transistors were concerned was the fact that an NMOS transistor, what is the problem with it? The weak one, right? It cannot transfer a strong one. That is to say, if you have VDD at the input, so an NMOS transistor, in other words, has this problem that if you have VDD here and VDD here, the output will go only up to VDD minus VDD. Right? Because once it goes beyond that point, effectively the VGS across the transistor drops below VT, it cuts off and no further current will flow. Same way, as far as the PMOS transistor was concerned, the problem that we had was the weak zero, right? The moment this drops below VT, it would take the VGS minus VT below the VT that is required for this transistor and no further current would flow. The output would not, assuming that of course the output was high to start with. Right? Assuming that the output was high, it won't be able to drop below VT. It is supposed to come to zero, but it won't drop below VT. Okay? So this problem for the NMOS is known as a weak one. For the PMOS is known as a weak zero. Right? Conversely, of course, the NMOS can transfer strong one, strong zeros, and the PMOS can transfer strong one. Okay? So a natural thought that pops up over here is, why not try and make the best of both? How do you do that? Combine both of them together into one circuit. Make it something like this. You have an NMOS transistor. On this side you put a PMOS transistor. Okay? The only catch here is the enabling signal. Right, supposing I put A over here, for the PMOS it has to be the opposite polarity, right, to enable it. So if A is 1, the NMOS will be on. If A is 0, or rather if A is 1, the NMOS will be on, but the PMOS will be off in this case. Right, so what you want is, you want to put A bar over here, so that irrespective of whether it is a 1 or a 0, the signal will get transferred properly. So whatever is the signal over here, B, will come through properly to 1. Okay? So for both cases, B equal to 0 and B equal to 1, it is transferred strongly over to 1. In one case, the NMOS will take care of it, in the other case, the PMOS will take care of it. Okay? So this structure over here is, or rather became sufficiently popular that it was given a name of its own and is used quite extensively in many different kinds of circuits. Okay? This structure is called a transmission gate. So its main, the idea behind it is simply that you have both the NMOS and the PMOS. One takes care of transferring strong zeros, the other takes care of transferring strong ones. At any given point in time, at least one of them is active. So either 0 or 1, the input will be transferred over properly to the output. Okay? Otherwise, it behaves exactly the same as a pass transistor. The idea is the same. Of course, you could argue that now you have doubled the size of the circuit because, you know, after all you need to use two transistors instead of one. Right? But the advantage of having strong zeros and strong ones was felt sufficient that, okay, this is worth it. This is worth it. Okay. So, transmission gates are used in a lot of different circuits. One of the most popular among them is something which can be used for implementing a large variety of different kinds of logic. Okay. So I'll just draw the circuit itself first and then let's look at what the functionality is that it implements. Circuit, what is the functionality that it implements? Right? So what is it? Let's write down the equation itself. What happens when S is equal to 1? When S is equal to 1, it means S bar is equal to 0. So the top transmission gate is on and the bottom one is going to be off. Okay? Which means that whatever is the value at A is going to come to Y. In other words, whenever S is equal to 1, A will be there at the output. And when S is equal to 0, the lower transmission gate will be on, the upper one will be off. So B will come through to the output. Okay? This is the equation of a multiplexer, right? So this by itself makes it a tremendously useful circuit, because just by using four transistors you have created a multiplexer. Normally if I wanted to implement a multiplexer in CMOS, then the logic is going to be much more complicated. I need to implement effectively two AND gates, an OR gate and some inverters in between. Okay. All of that essentially is saved by just using a single multiplexer that you have over there. Right? So in that sense it makes the implementation of multiplexers very easy and compact. Right? Of course, one important thing to keep in mind. What we have effectively done over here is we have taken two transmission gates and connected their outputs directly together to each other. Okay? In such a situation we need to make sure that at any point, only one of the transmission gates is going to be active. In this case, of course, that is automatically taken care of. But otherwise, if I had a situation where I had multiple transmission gates and I tie all their outputs together, I need to make sure that more than one cannot be active at the same time. So otherwise, we can have short circuits, right? One of the transmission gate inputs, in fact, that is trying to pull the output to 1, the other one is trying to pull it to 0. Both transmission gates are on. Effectively, I have a short circuit leading through one transmission gate, through the other one, down to ground. Okay. That sort of situation should not arise. In this case, of course, it cannot, because S and S bar are connected in such a way that at any point, only one of them can be off. Okay. So the fact that you can implement multiplexers like this, this is of course a 2x1 multiplexer. 4x1 larger multiplexers can also be implemented using some kind of cascade of transmission gates. Okay? Which means that the number of transistors that you require for this is not very large. Okay? Now, the next question that might arise is, what is the impact of a transmission gate in terms of delay? Right, how do you calculate the delay through a transmission gate? So, okay. Effectively, what we have is something like this. This is some load, okay. There is some select signal, which actually, if you look at it, does not play any part in the delay computation, because it's just a question of turning on the transmission gate. Right? So the delay finally is from this input A to the output, which is driving the load capacitor. Right? So the only difference, if you look at it, instead of a CMOS circuit where we had a path from VDD through a CMOS transistor to the output, or from ground through an NMOS transistor to the output. In this case, it is from the output of some logic through once again a transistor, right? NMOS, CMOS, whichever one, both of them, right? To the output. So effectively what we see over here is, something like this, right? So once again we have the same kind of situation. We have a resistance, we have a capacitance, the drain, or rather the source capacitance that we have over here. Okay, the parasitic. Sorry? No, both are on. Think about it, because S and S bar are connected. So both the transistors are on. It's just that only one of them is transferring a strong signal. Both are on. Okay? So because of that, anyway, as far as the capacitance is concerned, that doesn't matter whether it's on or off. Just the fact that there is a diffusion region over there itself leads to a capacitance being present. Okay? There is also some capacitance at this terminal, of course. What we do is effectively we group everything together and say that the equivalent circuit of a transmission gate is this. There is some R and some C. Okay? The actual size of a transmission gate depends on how you finally choose the sizes, how you want, what the R and C, the values that you want it to be. It's not as simple as the choice in the case of the inverter, where we just said that we wanted to have equal rise and fall time. In the transmission gate, remember both CMOS and NMOS are going to be on. Okay? In general, the same logic still holds. You want the same flow of current in both cases. You want the equivalent resistance to be the same for both CMOS and NMOS. So you would probably make the CMOS twice the size of the NMOS. Okay? But whether you want to size up the entire transmission gate, both the gates to be made larger, or you choose them to be of minimum size, is once again part of the design decision. Okay? Now, what this in turn means is, supposing you have a circuit that looks like this, okay, and this is actually not a very rare circuit. This will happen, for example, one example where you can think of this is in, let's say, a 4x1 or 8x1 multiplexer, right, where you will cascade transmission gates one after the other, right? The larger the multiplexer, the more transmission gates will be there in cascade one after the other. Another possibility where this comes up is in certain kinds of adder structures, which we will look at later. Okay? So in such situations, you will find that there is actually a chain of transmission gates that gets created. The effective equivalent circuit is this, right? Now, of course, we know how to deal with this. What is it that you need to do over here? Elmore's formula, right? So, in other words, when you have a chain of transmission gates, Elmore's formula once again kicks in. More importantly, one of the things that you will notice, and we will look at this later, probably in one of the tutorial questions. What do you do when you have a long chain of this sort? The delay, as we know, goes as square of the number of stages which you have. Right? So the longer the chain, the worse this becomes. So it might be that you don't want to have a very long chain of this sort. You need to break it up into certain stages. Okay? So that kind of a thing also needs to be taken care of. Right? We'll look at that in more detail in another tutorial questions later. Alright, so that's it as far as transmission gates are concerned. Right? What we are going to do now is continue with the different families of logic, but now switch over to something which is fairly different from everything that we have looked at so far. Right? Every family of logic that we have seen so far is a so-called static variety of logic. Okay? Why do we use the term static? The understanding that we have of static logic is that at any given point, when the inputs are not changing, the output is connected through a conducting path to either VDD or to ground. Okay? So think about that carefully. Let's just take an example. Input 0, it's connected through the CMOS. Input 1, connected through the NMOS. Right? This is conducting. What is the importance of it being conducting? It means that even if there is some kind of fluctuation or noise or something that happens which is trying to disturb the voltage at this point, how does that happen? It could be due to a number of reasons. I mean, in the worst case, it could even be that there is some kind of a high energy radiation that hits this area and tries to change the voltage, impart some charge over there and changes the voltage which is present over there. Right? In such a situation also, what will happen is because of this conducting path, finally the voltage at this point, Y, will become equal to the VDD. No matter even if something disturbs the value of Y. Okay? This is true for all the circuits that you have considered so far. This one, the pseudo NMOS, the DC VSL, even the pass transistor. Right? At any point in time, there is always one conducting path which takes you from the output to either VDD or to ground. It's definitely not to both. It has to be exactly to one of them. So that by looking at the circuit itself, you can clearly tell, is this output supposed to be 0 or is it supposed to be VDD? This is the path through which it is getting charged or discharged. What are the things that are keeping it on, keeping that path on? And in that way, you can tell for sure how the circuit works. Okay? All of these are so-called static logic family. For that reason, because under static conditions, that is to say, when the inputs are all unchanging, the output also has a conducting path to either VDD or to ground. Okay? Now let's look at the new family of logic that we are going to consider. The structure of the logic looks something like this. So there is one part that I have written as the PDN, the pull down network. This is the same pull down network that you would use in static CMOS. Right? So if it was a NAND gate for example, it would be two NMOS transistors in series. If it was a NOR gate, it would be two NMOS transistors in parallel and so on. Okay? What about the input, the other two transistors that are present over there? The inputs of course go over here to the pull down network. But there is some other signal which is not part of the regular logic. I am going to call it the clock. CLK. And connect that to both the CMOS and NMOS transistors. Okay. Now let's see how the circuit behaves. Alright. So the clock itself, I'm going to assume, is a square wave. That is to say, it is 0 for some time, 1 for some time, and alternating between the two. Typically the duty cycle will be 50%, but that's not absolutely necessary. Here I'm going to assume that it's 50%, but that doesn't really make a difference to the discussion. Okay? What happens? What happens when the clock is 0? What does the output look like? So when the clock is 0, the PMOS is on, NMOS is off. So what does that mean? Once the NMOS is off, the entire pull down network, doesn't matter what the inputs are connected to it, is disabled anyway. Right? But the PMOS is on, which is going to pull the output to VDD. Okay, so once the output is pulled up to VDD, what that means is that Y, every time that the clock becomes 0, Y automatically becomes 1. Okay, now what happens when clock becomes 1? The PMOS goes off, the NMOS goes on. Okay, what will happen to the output? It depends on the input. So it depends on the value of the input connected to the pull down network. Okay, so now if the pull down network is active, that is to say all the inputs are such that there is at least one path through that pull down network leading from the output to the bottom of that pull down network, it means that it's going to conduct. Okay? What does that mean? It will try to discharge. So the output will try to go to 0. Is there anything preventing it from going to 0? Nothing, because the PMOS is now off. Okay? So at this point, what happens is during each of these things, it is not that the Y is unknown, it evaluates the function. What does evaluate the function mean? It means that there is some function of logic that you are trying to implement using the pull-down network. And what this does is it implements that logic. If that logic was trying to pull the output down, then the output will go to 0. If there was no conducting path through the logic, what will happen to the output? It will remain at 1. Why? Why will it remain at 1? It will remain at 1 because implicitly there is some capacitance here. There is some load capacitance plus some parasitic capacitance which is going to hold the charge that is present at that point. Now you have turned off the PMOS, you have also turned off the pull down path through the NMOS. So there is no static path connecting it to either VDD or to ground. In the absence of any such part, normally the logic should just try and hold the last value that it had. Okay? That is what it does. It will remain at 1. Okay? Of course, there are problems with that. There might be leakage of current and so on. But except for that, it should do the work properly. Okay? So, the important part is, when clock is equal to 1 and the PDN is off, there is no static path. To VDD or to ground. Okay? This kind of logic is known as dynamic logic. So, dynamic logic, what is the main sort of defining characteristic? There is a clock that takes care of putting it through two different parts of its operation, right? The first part, clock equal to 0, is known as the pre-charge phase. During this time when clock is equal to 0, the output is unconditionally pulled up to 1. It doesn't matter what the input is. Okay? But the second time when clock is equal to 1, the output now depends on what the inputs are. In other words, it is evaluating what the input function is. So there are two phases, pre-charge and evaluate, and it keeps on alternating between these two in order to find out what the final output should be. Okay? Now, first question you might ask is, why are we even going for some kind of logic like this? Right? One of the main reasons why we look for different families of logic other than static CMOS, the main problem with static CMOS is simply the fact that you need that dual pull-up and pull-down network. That's a lot of transistors. Not only that, the pull-up network can be quite expensive. Why the pull-up network specifically? Because it is full of CMOS transistors. Right? And the PMOS transistors typically have to be twice the size of NMOS transistors for a given functionality. So the pull-up networks in general are more expensive. Which is why you will notice that all the logic families that I mentioned over here so far are trying to do something to replace the PMOS with something simpler. With either one PMOS for the entire logic or with one or two PMOS as in the case of DC-DSL. Right? Some kind of replacement of that sort where the number of PMOS transistors is kept low. By the way, side question, why is it that you never use PMOS transistors in the pull-down network? Simple answer. Right? Just what we discussed in the case of pass transistors. CMOS transistors transfer with zero. Pull down network needs to have strong zero. But CMOS transistors are strong ones, so they make ideal pull up network. Right? So it's as simple as that. That's the main reason why the pull-up and pull-down are exclusive to PMOS and NMOS respectively. In general, the PMOS transistors need to be bigger. So all the logic families that we have seen so far, try and replace the PMOS with something simpler. Go back and think about it. Just like we had pseudo NMOS or resistive load NMOS, you could have inverted the logic and made it resistive load PMOS or pseudo PMOS. Right? Or DC-DSL with two pull-down NMOS transistors, the sort of complement of every single logic family that we have seen so far is also possible. except for fast transistors. In the case of fast transistors, there's no complement. We consider both of them in here. Right? But in general, the complements are less interesting because they involve a lot of PMOS transistors and very few NMOS transistors. In general, they are going to be bigger. So we are not really that interested in them. Okay. Same case, dynamic logic. Once again, we are trying to reduce the pull-up network first. We have got rid of the pull-up network. We have replaced it with one PMOS transistor that just takes care of three charge alone. Okay. And you have, of course, this pull-down network as before. In addition, we have one extra NMOS transistor which is also there at the bottom of the pull-down network to turn off the pull-down network when necessary. Okay. So once we have this kind of structure, what it effectively means is the input load capacitance seen by the previous stage, or rather the load capacitance seen by the previous stage is going to be the input capacitance of these stages, which is in general going to be smaller because you don't have both the PMOS and NMOS that you are connecting to. You have only the NMOS. And the NMOS in general is smaller than the PMOS, right, for a given logic. Okay. Smaller load typically means faster operation. Right? So that is ultimately the main goal of most of the other logic families that we are looking at. Apart from that, as far as this particular dynamic logic is concerned, you can also think about it in terms of one sort of a trick over here is that because we know that there is this two-phase mode of operation, effectively what is the TPLS? What is TPLS? The propagation delay. Output low to output high. How much is that? See, think about it. How do you even define propagation delay for this kind of logic? The pre-charge phase, we know that you cannot really look at the output. It's no use looking at the output during the pre-charge phase because it is guaranteed to be 1. Right? So it doesn't really make sense to talk about propagation delay during the pre-charge phase. What we are interested in is, whatever is the output of this, during the evaluation phase, how long does it take to reach the correct value of the output? Okay? If you define propagation delay as that, during the evaluation phase, how long does it take to reach the correct output, then effectively the TPLS, the time to reach high, is zero. Okay? Now this is obviously a trick. It's not a sort of honest way of defining the propagation delay. But on the other hand, it is the only reasonable way of doing it because the pre-charge phase we know is anyway lost to computation. Right? Effective propagation delay is zero. TPHL on the other hand is determined by the pull-down network. So in the pull-down network, the same conditions that we had earlier still hold. We want to size the transistor such that, you know, the all different paths give the same resistance and so on and so forth. Okay? So those conditions still hold. Huh? Right. Now, so far we have looked at some of the plus points of the dynamic logic, right? Which is basically pure PMOS transistor, effective TPLS is zero, the pull-down network is made of NMOS, which is generally faster than the p-note or smaller for a given functionality. Right? But it has fairly major problems. The first problem that we can think about. What happens if the input changes during the evaluation phase? Let's consider two situations. One is the input changes from 0 to 1 during evaluation. Okay? So we are somewhere in the evaluation phase, input A changes from 0 to 1. What will happen to the output? Let's say that it was just a simple logic like this. Just an inverter. What will happen to the output here? Why? What will happen to Y? First of all, what will Y be during the pre-charge phase? VDD. During evaluation, it will remain as VDD over here. Then, once A goes to 1, Y should go down to 0. So there will be some small delay of this, right? This is the actual propagation delay through the logic. So this is fine. What if A instead went the other way? Y is high over here. But as soon as we go into evaluation, what will happen to Y? It will go down towards 0. Okay? Now what over here? It will remain 0. Okay? Even worse is, let's say A changes soon after now what happens to Y? It goes like this, it starts dropping. That neither 0 nor 1. Okay? So the pull-down network in this case is A. It is just one transistor A. Right? So A is initially 1. So it starts pulling down. But very soon after that A drops to 0. So it is no longer pulling down. Okay. So what happens in this case is A has changed from 1 to 0 very soon after the input, after it entered the evaluation phase. So in other words, the circuit, if you, to put it sort of crudely, the circuit thinks it is supposed to discharge, starts discharging, and before it has completed also, another signal comes along that says, no, you were not supposed to discharge. So the circuit gets stuck somewhere halfway between charging and discharging. Okay? So, one thing that we can see over here is, this will not work if the input is allowed First of all, what was the problem? The biggest problem that happened over here was that the input started from a 1. Okay? When it started from a 1 and then changed to 0 soon after the evaluation phase entered, that's when we ran into this problem. If it had started from a 0 and had undergone a transition to 1 at some point, anywhere in the logic, things would be fine. Another important thing is, what if it went from 0 to 1 and then went back to 0? That's also a problem, right? Because the moment it goes to 1 for some time, the discharge starts. Then if it goes back to 0 later, that's not acceptable. Okay? So in other words, only one translation on input per evaluation phase is allowed. Okay? And second thing is, if inputs are not ready before evaluation phase, input must be 0. To start. That's a slightly more complicated problem that we have over here. Okay? The second part, that the input must be 0 to start with, we'll deal with later. We'll get to that in a moment. Before that, there are some other problems also with this kind of dynamic logic which we need to study a bit more carefully. Okay? So this is a 2-input NAND gate implemented in dynamic logic, right? Now, one of the problems that we can see is, let's consider A equal to B equal to 0, right? Y should remain at VDD. Right? But there will be some leakage, sub-threshold current, and some reverse bias junction. Right? You look at the drain source junction, the drain to bulk and source to bulk junction, they are also reverse bias diodes. Some amount of current will flow through them anyway. Because reverse bias diodes also are not zero current, they are just very, very small amounts of current. What will happen as a result of that? There will be some amount of current which is a small leakage current flowing out of Y. There will also be some small leakage flowing into this because of the PMOS. But that's typically going to be a bit less than what is going to be the actual leakage out through the NMOS. Or may not balance. Chances are it will not balance out. Okay? So most likely what will happen is there will be some leakage of charge from Y which means that if the evaluation phase is long, the functionality will fail. What do I mean by functionality will fail? The while will no longer remain at VDD, it will actually drop by a significant amount over time. Right? What is the amount of time that we are talking about? Remember, these are like even picoamps of current can make a difference as far as the charge that is stored over here is concerned, because even the charge values are so small. And if by any chance you have something like nanoamps of leakage, there's a very good likelihood that within even something like milliseconds or so, enough charge would have leaked away that it actually makes a significant difference to the voltage stored at that point. Okay? Now what does milliseconds mean? It means that the minimum frequency of that clock, minimum frequency, the maximum duration of that evaluation phase cannot be more than so many microseconds or so many milliseconds. Right? Which means that the clock has to be greater than or running at a speed greater than so many kilohertz or so many megahertz. In other words, there is a minimum limit. There is a minimum clock speed required for the circuit to work properly. Okay? The next problem that we can also see over here is, and in fact this is one of the major drawbacks as far as this kind of dynamic logic is concerned. Right? Once you have a circuit using dynamic logic, for any other kind of circuit, as we will see later, we still haven't got to the point where we have done timing analysis, but you know the basics from digital design itself, from the basics of digital circuits. You know what is the determining factor as far as the speed of a circuit is concerned, right? You have some flip-flops in the circuit. There are combinational logic paths between flip-flops. There is some kind of a path delay from through the combinational logic. And the maximum path delay through the combinational logic is what determines your so-called critical path, and that in turn determines your maximum operating frequency. So that's as far as your maximum operating frequency was concerned. That never says anything about the minimum. And as far as static logic is concerned, any of the static logic families that we have seen so far, there was never any problem with the minimum frequency of operation. You could lower your frequency of operation as much as you want, so kilohertz to even hertz, and the circuit would still work correctly. Dynamic logic is not like that. You need to have a certain minimum operating frequency for the circuit to even work, to even function properly. Okay? Alright, there are a couple of other different drawbacks of this and some techniques that have been used in order to correct for this, which we will look at in tomorrow's class. That's it.